This is the second day and last day of our workshop on innovative practices in urban governance. Now we have received, we have got Mr. Sanjay Dubey, Divisional Commissioner of Indore. He is IAS officer of 1990 batch. He is presently working as Divisional Commissioner of Indore. He has won Prime Minister Excellence Award in 2008 and 2009 for removal of encroachment of structure. And he also bagged 7 national awards, including e-governance and improvement of mentally retarded children. Now we request him to deliver an interactive lecture on removal of illegal encroachment in the city. Please.
Very good morning. It's a great privilege to be back in Calcutta after 20 years. I remember that day when I was on a Bharat Darshan and had about a day at our disposal to move around in Calcutta. And I remember that despite a lot of tiredness, I preferred to move around in Calcutta onto the local buses, hipped and hopped, and reached Victoria Terminal, saw the Harbour Bridge. And since then, I had never had an opportunity of coming back. And that was a time when I also had visited ATI. So it's good coming back to the roots, it's good coming back to see that Calcutta has developed a lot, and in fact, the image that I was carrying through the movie called Kahani is totally shattered. I thought that it's as bad as it used to be, but now things are improving. There are a lot of improvement which has taken place in Calcutta, and I'm happy to be here amongst you. This is a story which I am going to share with you. Is of a time 2007-8 when I was collector of a district called Jabalpur, and there were a number of issues which I would deal with it. But essentially, to give you a background, I had demolished, before starting of this removal of religious encroachments, I had demolished about 20,000 residential and commercial complexes in and around Jabalpur. So that was the background that you can take it, because you simply can't go and walk and start demolishing removal of religious structures, because it requires something more than the normal encroachment removal practices. So going by that background, it was easier, little bit of easiness to me to go about doing this thing. Yeah, to tell you, this is Madhya Pradesh. Bhopal is the capital, and on the south eastern side of it, little south, most of it south and eastern part of it is a district called Jabalpur. The profile I'll let you know. But why the encroachment takes place and why it happens is something that I want to discuss, and what is the philosophy behind it. What happens is, as you grow up, as you are growing up, you would realize that you are quite used to seeing some kind of encroachments coming here and there, whether it is your town, it is your village, or it's a capital of West Bengal, or for that matter, anywhere including New Delhi. Our mind starts resisting this, that this is a common thing which happens, because now our mind is getting conditioned. You get conditioned in your circumstances by, say, if you are used to sharing of a towel with your family members, you don't mind sharing a towel again. But if you are not, your mind is not conditioned that way, you would really desist that kind of a situation. And similarly, your mind starts resisting that, yes, encroachment is a given thing. Religious encroachment is definitely a given thing, because that is little disastrous to touch this. In Jabalpur, it was religious encroachments of all hues and colors, of all faiths and religions, and they were all spread out into different locations, whether it's a park, public park, or whether it is a freeway, or whether it is a road, or whether it is even a sewerage, storm water drainage, or any other thing. The story is more or less same everywhere. It's not different if you go from Jabalpur to Delhi, or to Madras, or to even Calcutta. When we had done this, there were about 566 such religious places within the town of Jabalpur. So people used to say that if somebody has to be feeling religious about any place, you have to be in Jabalpur, because every half a kilometer you would have at least 4 or 5 of such temples, mazars or other structures. If you see it from the point of view of engineers, because I see some of the engineers here and most of you happen to be engineers, from the point of view of yours, the valuation of a land which was under encroachment by these religious places was worth 100 million rupees at that point of time. Why is it so much high? Because if you would see that they would be either at the crossings, the corners, or on the main road where the valuation of land is always higher than the valuation of land anywhere else. And they would be at the most strategic locations. And in these strategic locations, what you find is that it is not a simple religious reason why these structures have come up. It is because it is a business decision. And when a business decision, that is an economic decision, intermingles with the religious fervor, it becomes a heady mix of a violent bomb. Because it's not only a religious sentiments which are behind the construction of a religious place, it is also an economic decision taken by a person who has invested into construction of that religious place. And a religious place versus it, along with an economic decision, it's really very, very difficult. Why it's so? Because if you would see, a person who invests into construction of these religious places actually makes a business decision of calculating IRR and NPV on the investment that he is doing. When I say IRR, because he knows that he is doing an illegal act, he also knows that someday some ridiculous person might remove this. And at that point of time, he would not have any earning to be made from this. Here he is investing something, and he does that in the impression that till the time it continues, he is going to get all the kinds of benefits that accrue to this. He would let out the places which are just adjacent to the religious space. It will also be possible that he would construct his residential building over the temple. It will also be possible that probably the alms and the offerings that are coming to him is being pocketed 100% by him. So why it happens that you invest about lakh, 2 lakh, 50 lakh, whatever amount to whatever structure you are creating, but you are also having a daily routine. Besides that, people are now in position that they don't fix up a deity of single kind. You would have Sai Baba for Thursday, you would have Hanumanji for Tuesday, you would have Shankarji for Monday, you would have Saraswati Devi for some other day. So you have the full week scheduled so that you ensure that footfalls into your temple is a continuous and a regular process, just like any mall would try and find. So it is more of a, what I want to say is, it is not the religious faith, fervor, commitment where the religious places come up. It is more of an economic decision taken by an individual. Why this happens? Why this is happening continuously? It is because as a nation, we have failed. As an officer, we have failed. We have turned our eyes not to look. We have stopped registering this kind of encroachment, whether it is a normal encroachment, and particularly the religious encroachment that keep happening. There is a restlessness in the youth. They don't find themselves to be properly engaged. So what could be the other way of trying and achieving this? Let us have a religious place, probably we will be engaged, we will also have a starting earning from this, and that is how it happens. It is also because the political religious scenario is such that if I am successful in creating some religious place, possibly nobody will ever dare to touch it. And we all have the stories of Miss Nagpal everywhere. She even didn't touch it and she has to go. She has been suspended and nothing has been happening. Despite a lot of protection being given by the Constitution of India, by the conduct rules and everything in the All India Services. So, a person who does this knows that yes, it is possible for me to get out of it without having any harm to me. Rather, it is going to create a possibility where if anybody touches it, is going to bear the burden of it. Talking about Jabalpur, when we talk about it, we have to see that how replicable this model is. Is it really possible to be done in any other part of the country? And is it really possible to do so even in Madhya Pradesh? So it has a population of about 2.4 million, about 24 lakh people, having a mix of Hindu, Muslim, Christian. It was a cantonment, so you have a Christian population. It was ruled by certain people from Muslim denominations, so you have a Muslim population also, and as such Hindu population is a normal Hindu population. So there was a mix of all these things. Why I'm saying so is that whenever you have a mix of population, it is little more difficult, because you have to be then not only be identified as a person who has no leanings toward any particular religion, but you also have to show that you are interested in doing that. Jodhpur incidentally had a very checkered history of communal violence. On a number of occasions, right from 1956, there has been number of instances where a communal violence has taken place for a very small pretext, for a very smallest of incidents, where a person, Muslim person, brushes a Hindu person on a mobile. Possibly you will have a battery of people coming in on from both sides, and it will get turned into a communal violence at any point of time. And you have presence of right-wing organizations along with the prohibited organizations in Jabalpur. So much so that anything that happens, including the present person who has been arrested yesterday, if you trace the route, there would be some sympathizers available in Jabalpur also, either financing these kind of activities or would be giving them a safe house or a passage, all these kind of things. So given this kind of atmosphere which exists, given the kind of mix of population that exists in a district, it is a little difficult for you to take gadgets in your hand and decide about it. When we talk about this, we have to think about taking any decision. I'm going into the jugglery of management issues, whereby we say that we have to identify where are the stakeholders, who are the stakeholders. And here, obviously, elected representatives are the stakeholders, because that falls into the constituency. Priests or the caretaker of those temples or mazars are the stakeholders. Citizens, you and me, bear it out on a day-to-day basis. When we are passed by that, we feel congestion, we fib about it, we properly curse the officials, but we hardly do anything about it. Then we are officials, you and me, who are responsible for not letting this kind of encroachment first take place. And if they have happened earlier in the previous tenure, to ensure that they are out of these places. So in these circumstances, you and I have a responsibility, not as a citizen alone, but as an officials who are interested and given the power of removing this, to get rid of these kind of encroachments, whether it is a religious encroachment or a normal encroachment. But anybody trying to illegally encroach upon a government land has to get removed by you as per the norms, as per the law of the land. So this is a situation whereby a different individual would view this position from a different angle. The politician or the elected representative might feel that yes, this is a place where people do congregate, and if he goes there on a regular basis, probably people would align with him. On the other side, the priest have a stake that he would consider that if the people keep coming to my place without any dispute, and if I can increase upon the resources, then possibly I would have much more offerings to come through this temple. Possibly if it becomes more famous, there will be more shops who will try to come on that day. I will charge the rent from them. So it's an economic decision that he takes. His interest is to continue with the situation. Citizens probably feel that it should not happen or should not have happened, but still do nothing, because we are conditioned, or our conditioning of mind has taken so that we assume that this is something which we have to bear with. Officials, nahi kare to achha hai, why to take panga? Why to get into all this kind of a situation? I am very happy and strong in this position. If something goes wrong, who is going to support me? Who would answer this? And people would say, tumhe karne ki zarurat kya thi? That is what the question I face most of the time, that why did you do this? So that would be an answer which I will try to give it in the last when everything is over. But the point is that yes, there are situations, and the government institutions like municipal corporations, the urban local bodies, the bodies which are rural development bodies, officials, these are all stakeholders in this situation. We have all at some point of time had some lecture from management issues, and there you would find that it's a win-win situation, or win-lose situation, or lose-win situation, or lose-lose situation. it's essentially if there are two parties into an agreement or into a situation, any development or any situation would be sustainable only and only when every other party involved in it feels that they have won the situation. So win-win situation, that is if there are two parties and both of them feel that yes, they have negotiated the best deal available, possible deal for themselves, they will try to maintain that status. And if both the parties involved in the decision making or in the agreement phase or in the negotiations feel that they have clinched the best deal for their benefit, they would try to maintain that status quo. So that is the part where you are looking at is a collaboration. Party one could be a government like you and me, officials. Party two is supposedly a person who has encroached upon this. So the idea is that yes, as a party one and as a party two, this would be a lose-lose situation. Because both the parties feel that we haven't had a best deal available which they would have clinched. While the collaboration phase is where both the parties feel that we have clinched the best deal. In this removal of religious encroachments, essentially we have tried to be on that side of the scale, of the graph, where it is a collaboration. And how it has been achieved, if we have a time, we will discuss about it. But what I am trying to say is, because of this, this system has become sustainable. Now, to give you an example, what happened in Gujarat when they were trying to remove this religious encroachment, the administration took a stand that, look, I am not going to look at any other consequences but to bulldoze these. In bulldozing, party one feels that yes, they have won the battle, they are in the win situation. But party two, who are the encroachers, they feel that they have been short-charged and they will try to destabilize this equilibrium position because they, in their terms, have lost this. So on this scale, this is win for party one and lose for party two. In this scale, relinquish is loss for party one and win for party two. So how do I say relinquish is like, if there are encroachments, let it happen. Why am I bothered? If I am not bothered, I am not going to remove anything, I will let the encroachments continue. What would happen is party two would feel, look, how do you do that? Party 2 feels that here I am in a position where I am feeling he'll continue to do that because they have placed the best deal. Nobody is questioning their encroachments, nobody is doing it. But party 1, if you are conscientious enough and you feel that it is your duty, then you probably feel that I haven't done enough. So that is provided we feel that way. But if our mind is conditioned in such a way that yes, let it happen as it is, we have to pass away and while away our time and there are enough jobs are ahead by to take care of this issue, you can always not try to do this. So what is going to happen is, if it is a collaborative exercise, possibly this will continue, this will be sustainable. But if it is not a collaborative exercise, it would happen for some time, it may not happen for some time. And that is what we have to look at. What I am trying to say is, in a conflict resolution, if there are only two parties, it is a very simple matrix. The previous graph will be applicable. There are only two parties. But as I have told you, the stakeholders are multiple. So even this 2x2 matrix would become maybe 6x6 matrix. That is 6-dimensional problem. And when you have 6-dimensional problem, you have to arrive at a one particular point whereby everybody feels that it is a win-win situation. It is a very, very ticklish position. And above that, what happens is that the individuals have a different goal than the organization. As a party leader, if you are talking to me in person, I probably would agree to your suggestion. But when I have to take a public stand, I would not agree to your suggestion because there is a constituency, there is a follower team whom I have to satisfy. And possibly in circumstances, you would have appreciated it, and as an administrator, I appreciate it. That when you talk to MLA or MP in private, possibly they would say, haan saab, bilkul theek keh rahe hain, Malik saab, Commissioner saab, aap theek keh rahe hain, Haan sir, aap theek keh rahe hain. But kya karun, mere liye toh, this is important, so I have to take that stand. So though I am with you in person, but if you talk to me in public, I would not be able to support you. So when the situations, based on the situations, the reaction changes, it becomes still more difficult for you to convince a person to agree to a situation of removal of encroachments. Now, why it is that we started it? What happened is when I took over as the district magistrate of that place, Jabalpur, there was already a PIL filed by lawyers saying that there are number of encroachments, particularly of religious nature, which have hindered the passage for the common man. It is already pending. There was about 6 months that has elapsed since this was ordered by the Chief Justice, Honorable Chief Justice. And the previous DM said that it is very difficult for me to execute this order, and that is why he said that nothing can be done. Obviously, it is the PIL, the district magistrate, the municipal corporation, municipal commissioner, and the SP got called in personal hearing, and the Chief Justice hears me out and he says that why nothing has been done. That was the first, just after a month I have taken over. I was called for this. So I had a very great excuse. I said, sir, I have just taken over. I am not yet aware of the issues that are there in the district. I am trying to grapple with them. But obviously, I will give a decent and a patient way in which I will try and do this. I could have said that, look, this is fraught with danger. This is a law and order situation. If something goes wrong, it would be very difficult for you to contain this. So what they did is, very intelligently, they passed an order saying this, that district administration is hereby counseled and advised that they should try and remove these religious encroachments without hurting the sentiments and the feelings of any religious or a communal group. And they have to see that there is no law and order situation getting created because of this. They have empowered you, but without any arms. They have empowered you without telling that you can't do this, but you still you have to try and do it. Perfectly fine. It is a way you have at least something to make the people realize that there is something to favor you. But that is what it is. So the status quo was maintained. The order was such that neither you know that you have to go ahead do this, nor you know that whether you have to, after 3 months, again stand before the court and with a folded hand say excuse or sorry for this. So what we did is, and there is no precedence also. So you don't have, in government what we do is, if there is a GO government are fine enough, there is administrative order, that is also okay. If there is some precedence of that kind, that is also okay. At least we can proceed in a particular direction. But here you are grappling in the dark. You don't realize that it is there, such situation has ever existed or is there in which it has been tried out. And how do you actually do it is something that you have to evolve during the process. So it is not a very well thought strategy that was initiated. It was a hit and trial method that we tried and thought of before proceeding further. So the best and the easiest way to do is call a peace committee meeting. I don't know what happens here, but for every religious festival that is organized, there is a peace committee meeting headed by a district magistrate in which SP and the municipal commissioner are the members. All MLAs, all MPs, would be MLAs and would be MPs, ex MLAs and ex MPs, some religious gurus are essentially the member of peace committee. This peace committee is a two-way sword, in the sense that if you haven't held the peace committee meeting and something goes wrong in some religious festival, the first question that the government asks is, have you ever called these peace committee meeting in which you have discussed this issue? Like if it is a route which you need to change, or if it is the timing of a particular festival that has to be decided, this all has to be discussed in the peace committee meeting. So I thought that that is the forum in which we can possibly decide about this, discuss about it, and see as to what reaction the people are going to give for this kind of thing. So we innocently started having discussions. The Eid ka festival tha, we called for a peace committee meeting after the discussions of safai, pani, supply, electricity, etc. was discussed. We said that here is such and such instructions by the High Court and we should try and do it because it is good for the development of the world. It was a disaster. Simple disaster. Everybody stood up unanimously. They stood up, walked out of the room and said, over our dead bodies, Mr. DM, forget about it. This cannot happen if we are there. We can't support you on this nonsensical approach. You have just become a district magistrate of this Jabalpur. You don't know what kind of people are here. You would not even survive for a day. Forget about thinking of this. Perfectly fine. Now you are in a casualty position. On one hand, you want to do it. You have something as an instruction from a high court. But on the other hand, you know that it is very difficult. You started discussing with the subordinate officers. You said, sir, kuch nahi ho sakta. It is something that you have to face. And one doesn't know the consequences. So what we did is, we said that, okay, we'll try and do the procedures. There was a traffic safety week which is organized in almost every part of the state. So on that particular day, there is a chance when the SP and the DM speak out to the common man, it's covered well in media. So what we did is we started talking about it, saying that look, because of this religious encroachment, there is a lot of inconveniences which is being caused to the persons who are traveling and taking that route. There is a lot of congestion, there is a lot of pollution, all those things, and there are a lot of accidents which occur because of this, and people lose life or their essential parts of the body because of these bottlenecks that get created onto the main roads. So we should do something. But that was it. Like, people covered it, people didn't cover it, it was taken. Oh yeah, it was a kind of a normal routine kind of process. It happened. Nothing happened. Nobody bothered about it. DM ne bol diya hai, SP ne bol diya hai, it is a ritual, it has been done. Forget about it. Then on Monday I was thinking about it, and the mayor of that particular place, she happened to be a lady at that point of time, and I have rescued her from different positions, particularly when the councillors are opposing the mayor and you are not in a majority in the house. In the mayor, you are actually literally dependent upon some of the official acts also. So on one or two occasions, she was indebted to me to a certain extent. And as a district magistrate, you are there to support any institution of the government if they are doing a good job. So then I told mayor that we need to fight out. She said, what? We have such a good relation. Why do you want to fight and have a fight? I said, not literally, ma'am, but the issue is that we would like to fight it in media and public. She said, what is going to be the purpose for this? I said, unless we create new sense, it will not make a new sense. For a very simple reason, that we have tried to create a situation whereby people can actually have registered this, that we are particularly keen in removing this religious encroachment, but nobody bothered. So let us find it out. You blame me that I am a district magistrate who is not removing any religious encroachments, and because of which you are not in position to widen these roads while you have the funds and you are missing. So you have funds, you want to widen this road, which is your prerogative, but you can't do because there are bottlenecks created by this religious institution. You are in very much in right position to blame a district authorities of not doing anything in support of creating this infrastructure. So people would feel that yes, it is there. And then I will say that yes, I am trying to do this, but there is no support. And we will say no, not it's not the job of a district magistrate, it is a municipal corporation, because they are the local bodies. They are supposed to do it. We can only provide them the background support. So let us have a fight. When you have a fight, it will create a new sense. And when it creates a new sense, the newspaper would cover it. And believe me, on the next day when we had this literal in one of the meetings, when we had this issue, every newspaper in their headlines, every media, every white person whosoever comes to you and places a mic before you and says, sir, bite the DG as if they are going to bite you, was everybody has covered it. What happened with this? The silent majority, which is almost 95% time, is 95% of your population, started discussing about it. As a district magistrate, as an official, you would realize that it is only less than 5% of the people who would ever come to visit your office for the good work or a bad work or for your position or support. 95% of population would never ever visit any government officer, particularly the district magistrate. Very few would. So what happens is, if you are creating issue, if you are doing something, what exactly happens is, you are only governed by the views and the issues of these 5% of the population in your district. 95% of the people would be a silent majority who would neither say yes for your initiative nor would oppose for any wrongdoings that you are doing. It is only the 5% who would decide whether you are there or you are not there. So what happened is, these people, the panthera wala, the taxi driver, the press hawker, they all started discussing that there is an issue. And that is the victory, that if you have created an issue whereby people start registering that this is a problem, this needs to go, this has to get removed, you have won half of the battle. Because you know now that if you are able to do this, 95% of these people are not going to support any rumor mongering. They will not support anyone who is trying to bifurcate the society or would try to mobilize the society on the name of a religious interest. This is okay. This is media management or whatever you might say. But then the ground reality is where our engineers have to play a role. What we did is we created a team of three individuals, one from police thana, one from a revenue authorities, and one from municipal corporation. And we said that first let us assess what amount of problem we have. What is the problem that we have at our hand? So what we did is we divided the whole area as per the thana wise, because you have a jurisdictional area of a police station. On that police station, we posted one revenue authority official and one municipal corporation's engineer. And we said that we will map and mark each and every religious place as to how much area that they have encroached upon, when have they constructed this religious place, who has constructed this, what is the valuation of the land which is encroached, what is the valuation of the property that they have created, who are the people who are supporter of this religious place, who are the ones who are taking care of this, and what is going to happen if this is removed, and when was it constructed. This all was done because we thought that unless we size up the problem, we cannot initiate any action. So this was done with the help of every official. Having lost in a peace committee meeting, we thought that it will not be easier to convince everybody. And as I have told you, that my experience goes that if you individually talk to a person and reason with them, possibly if you are reasonable and you are on a right track, people in person would probably support you. So what we did is we constituted a team of like me and my SP, went to some of these religious groups and discussed with them that this needs to go. Even in Muslim areas, I gave them an example of Sharjah and Dubai and other places where they keep removing, shifting madras and mazars and dargahs. I also kept on saying that temples have been removed earlier also, and no religious faith or their religious books ever propagate encroachment on the encroached religious places. So if you have to construct a temple, if you have to construct a mazar, it has to be a non-disputed place. And that is what we argued, because we tried to do some research to find out which are the places which have allowed the removal of the religious places for the development. In personal meeting, most of them agreed that aap jo keh rahe ho theek hai sir, lekin ye sambhav nahi hai, because you probably remove this, but what will I tell to my followers, what would happen to the other people, and I am not very sure what kind of a reaction might come from other persons. So individually what we try to do is to minimize the reaction so that we can argue it out, and there we said that okay, if you are not willing to support our cause, at least you can keep mum in the peace committee meeting when we call it next, or at least you can say that there are some issues which we have to settle down. So some of the Hindu religious people said that look, it is easier for you to remove a temple, but what happens to a mazar? You would start shivering when you have to remove this mazar, because you people have been removing temples, but not a mazar has ever been shifted out. And their point was, I am ready to get rid of my temple provided you are willing to remove the mazar. So that was a kind of a buyback they were saying. While the Muslim religious said that look, in our Shariat, in our book, Quran Sharif, it is not possible to remove any person, because in mazar there is a person who is buried inside, and you cannot show disrespect and disregard for a person who is buried inside, who is no more on this land. So they said that this is not possible, and at least I cannot support it. Then we argued it out that there is a certain size, there is a certain dimension, there is a certain layout in which a mazar could be constructed. And if it is not being followed, then possibly there is nobody inside, buried inside. So you have to see that if it is real Maulana, if there is a real person who has ever been buried inside, yes, we respect that. But if there is no such and it is only made to have the encroachment done, then possibly we have to think of it. Somehow people were little bit made to understand our issue. None of them agreed, but they said that look, if you are insisting upon, we possibly would be able to support you, provided you act in a very transparent manner, if you act in a very, very equitable manner, you act in a manner in which there is no discrepancy between the two or three faiths. So we agreed for this. And what we did is, to assess the reaction of the public, we said that let us have a police level meeting in which all these people who were the caretakers of these religious places were called. You have a different attitude and a different response from a public when they are called in a police station than into any government office. In police station, they know that if they are doing some miscreation, possibly police would held them responsible. So what we did is, in police committee meeting, we said the TI would chair that meeting and the local authorities of municipal corporation, revenue authorities would sit there. And they will thresh this issue out, discuss this issue out that look, I want to remove this and whether I don't want to remove this. And in that situation, we would like to gauge the reaction of a common man. Whether the priests are vocal enough, whether they are threatening that they will create a law and order situation, whether they are saying that there are a certain follower who is going to support them in not removing these religious places, or they say that it is a deity which is established well before it. So all these things were the part of it. What we did is, if you see, there are two very adverse situations. One is the CRPC, IPC and the municipal corporation law says that encroachment on a government land is not permissible. On the other hand, there is an act of Government of India which says People's Worship Act 1991, if you recall that it was passed in the wake of Babri Masjid. So what had happened is in 1991, when Babri Masjid was to be demolished, was getting demolished or other threat, the Government of India passed an order saying that if a religious place existed as on 1997, the religious place will not be disturbed. The structure, the nature, the character of that religious place cannot be disturbed if it existed as on 15th of August 1947. Now, on one hand, you have the legal provisions which support your action of removal of these encroachments. On the other hand, you have to have this. So, here in the police committee meeting, what we tried to find out is, when was this constructed? So that we can take a view that it was constructed after 15th of August 1947, and that is why it is not essential for us to follow and respect this religious place, just because there is no act which protects it. So, what has happened is that this has given us the last in the final column in the survey list, when was it constructed? We could also assess the, what kind of a reaction is going to come in, what personalities on which personalities are going to oppose our movement of removal of this encroachment. And then it also led us to own up this decision, because once the TI is involved in the negotiations, when the local authorities are involved in the negotiation, it was not and no more was a decision of a district magistrate or an SP. It was a decision of that group which was constituted in it, because we said that if you say that in your supervision area, these are the places that needs to go out to be removed, this will be decided by you, not by me. So what has happened is the whole team got involved. They started owning up this decision that yes, we are the ones who are deciding which religious place has to go, which religious place has to stay. And that is why we as a team could gain a confidence of our subordinates. It was a long-run process of consultation. It was also, we call it a Sam Dam Dand Bhed. As Chanakya has said, that an administrator has to use all his resources at his disposal, whereby you can threaten, you can give some kind of a, you can lure them to a certain position, you can say, I'll issue an arms license in your favor. You can also threaten that I'll cancel your arms license if you probably try and create a nuisance for this kind of situation. You can say that I will benefit you in this position because your application is pending in my office. You can always say that yes, you have not been complying with me, so possibly I'll try and take an adverse action on your situation. So basically it was a carrot and a stick approach that we tried to use it to minimize the reaction that was supposed to come. And we also gave them enough time. We decided that yes, if this has to go, it will not go tomorrow, it will not go day after. You are given a 1 month notice, you do whatever you want to, but after 1 month we are going to move this. What we actually did is, once we had this survey conducted, we realized that it is not easy for us to actually demolish this until we take up the easiest target first. I could have taken a bigger temple, which is more popular temple against this removal, but then the reaction would have been very huge. So what we said is that first have an easier step, first let us attempt an easier question. And what we did is a civil lines area in which most of the officials stay. There are small temples and mazars which have got erected over the period of a time. And there we have said that we identified 2.5 kilometers of a patch of a road in which there were 11 such religious places. 7 were Hindu temples, smaller temples, and 4 were mazars, we said to have the transparency, to have the equitable removal of this, we said 2.5 km of road, it needs to be widened up. All the religious places which come in this will have to go, whether it is 5 Hindu or 15 Hindu, it doesn't make a difference. Because that is the only way possibly we could have tried and removed this. Otherwise, if we would have gone for one temple, one mazar, probably we would have been left with 250 temples, because there were not an equitable distribution of mazars and temples. The church was only one which was under encroachment, which we removed. So if we go by that kind of a thing, probably I would have removed only one church, one temple and one mazar. But I took a decision that transparency, equitable distribution or equitable treatment of this situation will be that in all those places which are coming in this particular area or a land which is identified for a development will have to go. And that was the easiest target of 2.5 km of a land having 11 religious places. That was the first target that we identified that we have to go. When we have decided the date and we give them the time, enough time for them to react so that we can assess how they are performing, that was okay. But then the point is, when you have to do this kind of a thing, you have to overcome your own fear. A fear that you are not an atheist, you are a religious person. I myself do pray twice a day, and you bow before the God and ask for all kind of excuses, and suddenly you are made to now remove these religious places. You are going to demolish these religious places. So what you have is an inner fear into you, where you feel that there might be something which might go wrong to you or to your family if you are doing this. Now this is something, unless you draw out your strength from within, you possibly will not be able to do it. I possibly will not be able to do it. So it was a very difficult situation whereby you are not very convinced that what you are doing is right or wrong. How is it going to finally transcend or get converted into? Okay. You might be driven by a force of a duty. You feel that yes, it is your bounden duty to do this, to follow the law of a land. You are given this responsibility. You have been picked up by the UPSC because it is considered that there are officers who will do this kind of work. But what would happen to your family? Your kid would come running, my small child came running to me, "Why, Papa, you are doing this? We go to temple every day, we do prayer every day, and then you are removing Goddess Durga and you are removing God Shiv and everybody." That's okay. My wife, who is a doctor, she said, "Why do you want to become a Mahmood Ghaznavi? There are enough people who have earlier done this, but why do you want to charter your name into the history whereby you have been identified as a demolition man of religious places?" It was a difficult decision. But all of us sat together before the night of removal and we said that yes, we are trying to do the best and let us leave it to the God, because the God has destined us to do this, that is why we have come so far. So that is okay. You have been driven by some duty and some kind of a conscious decision. But what happens to a person who is actually going to demolish? Because it's not the DM who is going to demolish. Somebody has to hammer the statue out. Somebody has to drive this JCB to demolish the structure. And they are the ones who are the local guys, who have been there for years together, who are going to be there for years together when you are posted out of that particular place. And they are the people who have been visiting these places. And it becomes very difficult to convince them that what they are doing is right and justified and it would not create any harm to them. So that is where you have to negotiate, renegotiate, give them a training, give them instill a sense of duty into them that what you are doing is not going to bring any wrath to you or to your family. Having done that, you have seniors. The divisional commissioner would say, which I am right now, "Why the hell are you going to do this? Who told you to do this? Something goes wrong, who is responsible?" The government is going to ask you that why you have created an unnecessary situation of a law and order. Everything was going on smoothly. The developmental activities were going on smoothly. There was no situation which should have occurred. But here you are creating and trying to incite the feelings, religious feelings, unnecessarily. And there I have to tell to my commissioner at that point of time, "Sir, I have taken a conscious decision. I am convinced that I will be able to handle this. But if there is something wrong, yes, I will take the brunt." Having done that, the divisional commissioner was good enough not to stop me. He could have very well said that it is not your bounden duty to do this. You stop doing this because I don't permit you to do the same, because it might lead to a situation which is very adverse. Wo bhi aapne kar liya. But what happens to elected representatives? They are stakeholders in this. They will object to it. And they did that, no doubt about it. So why? We started talking to them in the terms that they understood the best. And that is the language of vote politics. Simple. I said, sir, 95 and more than 95% of the common man would support you in this cause if you are able to get this religious basis out of this place. 5%, I agree. The 5%, the vocal ones, the important ones, possibly will be able to oppose this most vociferously, would try and oppose this movement. But if you will ask 95% of a common man, he would say, yes, I appreciate and I support this movement because they face day in and day out this kind of a problem, which you and I don't face. And if you have to win over the hearts of these people, here is a position probably you can do it. And over and above, I said them, I told them a way out also. That look, sir, if everything goes on, you can take up credit. But if anything goes wrong, you can always blame me, that I was the one who did this nonsensical thing, and you can conveniently shift me out the next day from the district magistrate position. And they said, yes, chitti meri or patti meri, if I am getting the benefit, why not to take it? And they understood that. And they allowed, and we negotiated a deal, whereby we said that on the day that we would be doing this, what are supposed to be done by them, that I will discuss it later. But yes, we took a calculated risk of not doing it. On that D-Day, we had a heavy deployment in sensitive places because there was a mix of population and different pockets. So not only at the places that we are removing these encroachments, we also did a position whereby something might go wrong at some point of time. Day was fixed as Wednesday because that was a day when we had no religious festival. That was not a day of a deity most of the time. There was no VIP movement in that, and political bosses were politely requested to be out on that day on so-called a rural tour whereby they were unapproachable, even by the mobile. And the deal was that I'll keep them informed and they will not receive any phone calls. Only if they have anything to say, they would talk to me and I'll keep them on the knowledge that something is going wrong or something is going well. The idea was very simple, that if they stayed in that particular locality on the day of removal, possibly the people would go and ask them to stop this. And they possibly would have only two options, either to say yes, I will tell the district magistrate, or they say no, which is not possible for them to say no to their followers. They would have to ring me up, and in ringing me up, the possibility is that either I have to stop, which means that I stop the removal altogether for all times to come, or if I don't abide by them, it creates a situation of embarrassment for a political boss. So to avoid embarrassment, not to create a situation in which they feel particularly bad, we said that all of you, and incidentally at that point of time, there were quite a few ministers coming and hailing from that particular district. So what we did is, they were all out on a rural tour. They were not approachable by any mobile, because the switches, mobiles were put off, and we were only exchanging the developments of this. Fortunately, when I was trying to do all this, there was one of the press person who happened to be developed a relationship and mutual respect for each other. He said, sir, if you are going through this, even if you are successful in removing this without creating any problem, what is going to happen is later on some people might say that you have hurt the religious sentiments while removing this. So it is better that you do Fatiha recital before you actually remove the mazar and do the puja before you do the removal of a temple. I thought that it makes sense to show all our respect to the religious deities. And we actually convinced the priest and the maulvis of that particular place to come on that day. We paid them and told them that on Wednesday you are supposed to be here. We would, before removing this, we would do this puja. On Wednesday, these people never turned up, because they were told by the concerned people that if you go there, you are no more a priest or a maulvi of our faith. And then what we had to do is, we picked up officials from our team, Muslim official who actually was made to rope the green clothes to act as a maulvi. We purchased yellow ropes for our Hindu person who was taken up, who did the puja in temple while the Muslim person did the Fatiha recital in mazar. We video recorded that so that we could prove later that we have not and done anything illegal or hurted the sentiments of any religious faith. And then what we did is we started removing the deities or the idols from that person for that particular place. After having removed this, then we demolished the structures. The situation was that we have already, since we have identified this patch, we have already got the sanction from the municipal corporation. The agency was already fixed. So as soon as we removed this, the debris was removed immediately. The development work started the very next day. So that by the time you return back from your office, when you have gone there, you saw the temple. When you are returning back from your office, you realize that there is no more temple existed. There is no debris existed, and the development work has started. So what has helped is the people realize that it is for the development that we are removing this. It is going to create a situation which is favorable for them. And that is why most of this silent majority, which I was talking about of 95%, actually didn't support any of the adverse publicities or any of those things which have tried to instigate their religious power or feeling. And that is where we thought that it is important for us to take them into account. And there, we were successful because on the next day when the media covered it, they gave a very positive feedback of it. And once the media start talking very positive about it, you possibly have a very good support coming from the common man, because that is how the psyche develops. Having done so, what has been the results? 311 religious sites were removed in my 2.5 years of my tenure without creating any law and order situation. You won't have heard about it. Not even my chief minister knew when I had started removing this. Only after 50 of such removals that he got to know about it, and he said, "Kya kar rahe ho?" Then I tried and explained him, and he said, "Okay, go ahead. Do it if you are able to do this. Continue doing this." Till date, it is 456. And remember, 566 for the religious structure, 456 have already gone in Jabalpur. Only town in the country which has created this model whereby you don't have any deployment of force now. It is demolished every week on every Wednesday in one place or the other without even involvement and knowledge of a district minister, because the subordinate machinery has now geared up so well that it works as a well-oiled machinery. And since I have left, there are 3 district magistrates. In my tenure, there were 3 municipal commissioners, 2 SPs who were there with me who have supported this. So it is now totally protected from individuals, from individual initiatives. It is now an ongoing process which has got so much imbibed and institutionalized in the system that if I afford not to remove this, I will be under tremendous pressure from a common man that you have to do this. There is nothing to do with now X, Y or Z. It is the position of a DM, whosoever happens to be a DM, has to execute this work. And I am quite sure that days are not far when we will claim that there is no religious place existence on the public lands in Jabalpur. There was no loss to life and property. We have recovered valuable land. As you would have seen that in most of the religious festivities, we have to safeguard these places for any untoward accident. And besides that, we have prevented that, and besides that, it has enhanced self-confidence and confidence in the machinery. Now, we can say that with great satisfaction that we have institutionalized this and have kept an effective check on the tendency. Now, it so happens that if there is some effort made by encroachment, by encroachers to create some religious place, the DM gets an SMS from a common man. He would say, or ring up, "Sir, wahan wahan par ye, this activity is going on. I am fearing that this would happen. In a day or two, a religious place would come up." So before even it got institutionalized, the district magistrate sends a team, removes it. So what has happened is, not only we have removed the previous ones, but we are also preventing from not new construction to take place. This is all. There are certain photographs. I have a 10 minutes clipping which I'll show to you. Some of you would have got bored listening to me, but when you see the movie, it's always entertaining and interesting. So that movie would be there, which will give you how the steps have been taken. Then I would be open for any questions that you would see. These are some photographs. The church going, the temple again going, this mazar being shifted. This temple, the huge temples, 3-story temples, 2-story temples, not a small sideways temple. And this is particular residential and other things. So this is what we have done. I'm open to any kind of questions that you would throw up. Even before the movie, or if you would like to see, then I'll show you the movie first and then we would have a series of questions to answer in case you have any. Can I request the lights to be switched off? I want a documented kind of professional thing, but yes. And it is dedicated to him, Sanam Jabalpur.
किया जाए, कोशिश की जाए और अगर संभव हो तो को तोड़ना तो दूं, ऐसा सोचना भी जहां खतरे से खाली ना हो वहां 566 धार्मिक स्थलों को ध्वस्त करने के लिए जिला प्रशासन ने कमर कस ली। बैठकों ने दौड़ पर दौड़ चलने लगे, कभी पंडितों को बुलाया गया तो कभी मौलवियों को, कभी आग्रह किया गया तो कभी आदेश दे दिया गया।
जब हमने बातचीत की तब ये बात बहुत स्पष्ट की थी और मुझे वाक्य भी याद है कि हमारा आग्रह भी है और आदेश, और मैं समझता हूँ कि ये अपने आप में पर्याप्त था कि प्रशासन से अपेक्षा कर रहे हैं सहयोग, लेकिन अगर ऐसा नहीं किया जाता है तो आवश्यकता पड़ने पर कठोर कार्रवाई भी की जा सकती है। और मुझे खुशी इस बात की है कि सभी लोगों ने बहुत अच्छा सहयोग दिया, इसके फलस्वरूप हमें कहीं भी कठोरता का परिचय नहीं देना पड़ा, आराम से हद से इन धार्मिक स्थानों को हम आम रास्ते से था।
बात सबके घरों की थी, खुदा के बंदों की हिफाजत की थी और मकसद भी नेक था। लिहाजा सभा को समझ आ गया और बनने लगा मददगारों का कारवां।
मैसेज तो मैसेज ये है कि इंसानियत तो सब बराबर है, सब कुछ आते हैं, एक मुल्क में एक शहर में एक बस्ती हो सब मिलजुल का मोहब्बत के साथ रहे, जब शहर का विकास होगा तो फायदा भी मिलेगा और आगे वाली जनरेशन को मिलेगा। थोड़ी तकलीफ तो ये बर्दाश्त करेंगे, आने वाली फायदे उठाएंगे।
जिला प्रशासन के हाथ में था मध्य प्रदेश हाईकोर्ट का आदेश और सत्ता की बेशुमार ताकत, लेकिन उसने प्रेम और आस्था की ताकत पर ज्यादा भरोसा किया। मस्जिद मजार तोड़ने से पहले फातिहा पढ़ी गई तो मंदिरों को हटाने से पहले की गई पूजा अर्चना, योजना के मुताबिक बुलडोजर गरजने लगे और गिरने लगे पूजा स्थल।
अब यार अलग हो गया, अब तो डेवलपमेंट हो रहा है, रोड का बाहर जगह के मंदिर मंदिर हट रहे हैं।